reading a little bit of one of Ernest's books this week called Can We Talk to God? Interesting question. Can we talk to God? But I was reading that book and I thought, maybe a bigger question is, because I think, can we talk to God? Absolutely. Maybe a bigger personal question is, can I listen to God? Can I listen to God? Can I listen? One of the things that I know about spirit is spirit never competes for airspace. It just doesn't. So what that means is, if my mind is full of clutter and it's busy and I'm stuck with what I have to do, or maybe I'm upset or whatever, when my mind is cluttered like that, I am not able to listen to that small, quiet voice. So if we think about the answers are always in the back, the answers could be there in the back of all of this clutter and turmoil in my mind, but I'm not going to hear them. Until two things, I think, mindfulness and awareness. So I think we can think of mindfulness as whatever we do in our individual lives, and I'm sure we all have different ways, but mindfulness is what brings us in to the present moment. Awareness is what is happening in that present moment. So I think they go beautifully together when we're thinking about, can we listen to God? First, we become mindful, and that brings us into the present moment, and we're behind all of the clutter in our mind. And then when we do that, we can have the awareness, okay, so what is really happening in this moment? What is God saying to me? What is here for me to listen? So now my talk title. The answers are always in the back. So Wednesday morning, Peggy called me and asked me for a talk title. And I said, I don't have an inkling. Didn't even have an iota of an inkling of what I wanted to talk about, which was a little disconcerting because usually by Wednesday I have something. So I was having lunch with a friend and I went to pick up my friend Tree. And we're chatting along and she was getting ready for a craft show and she said she'd been really stressed, but she said, oh, thank God for Sudoku. And she was saying that one of her de-stressors is Sudoku. Well, years and years ago, I used to do Sudoku. Well, I haven't done it in a really long time. And a couple of months ago, I bought a Sudoku book. I couldn't even do the easy one. I got so frustrated and all these tapes came up that I'm stupid, I'm not smart, and I threw the book away. So what my friend said was, but the answers are in the back. They are. See, look, if you open up a Sudoku book, all the answers are in the back. And I said, that's cheating. That's cheating. She said, it is not cheating. The answers are in the back to help you. And I was like, oh. And she said, why not? When she gets stuck, she doesn't get frustrated. She goes to the answers in the back, gets the two or three numbers, fills them in, and keeps on going. And I was like, oh my goodness, what a great title for a talk. The answers are always in the back. And here they are. The answers are always in the back. And I think it's true both literally and metaphorically. I didn't think about this until last night, but I actually had started this talk title last week, if you were here last week, or hi, if you're on Zoom. I know I have friends on Zoom and we have people on other platforms. Something happened that had never happened before. I couldn't pick between two readings. So I had two readings up here and both were the last page. I know I shared that. Both were the last page. And I just figured when I came up to do my reading, I would know which one it was. So I picked up one of them. That was grand. Well, then I messed up. I messed up the order of service last week. And that gave me the opportunity to do another reading. So I had got to do another answers are in the back. So that was super cool to think about that I already started it. I have a very deep appreciation and gratitude for the teachings of A Course in Miracles, and a great gratitude for a man called Jerry Champolsky. If you've ever studied A Course in Miracles, it can be a little tough going. It's not easy reading. So Jerry Champolsky is this brilliant man who many years ago took the principles of A Course in Miracles and he put them into very simple layman's terms. And what he put it down with a single goal, and the single goal is inner peace. And how we get to inner peace from the Course in Miracles and then from his interpretation, we get there through one thing, and that is through forgiveness. Through forgiveness. Interesting. Never given a talk about forgiveness. A couple of weeks ago, a dear friend and spiritual teacher in my life wrote the most beautiful, profound, vulnerable email. It brought me to tears, just brought me to tears. He was in that place of having had a biopsy and waiting for the result. And as someone who's been in that journey, I know how that feels. And I know that the healing opportunity there is to live in the uncertainty. Oh, and that brings up something I meant to say. Last week, Home Office gave us an acronym of HOME. It's beautiful, beautiful. Healing opportunities manifest everywhere. Isn't that beautiful? An acronym for HOME. Healing opportunities manifest everywhere. So my friend obviously was pretty distraught that he was waiting on the results of a biopsy. And he was expecting to have to process out the fear and what happens if it comes back positive. What happens if I mean, he thought that was where he was going to go. That was not where he went. And he was really quite shocked where he went. So the healing opportunity that manifested for him as he was waiting this result was his mind became obsessed with what had happened 25 years ago. He felt as raw as he did 25 years ago when he felt wronged by this woman. Excuse me. It was as raw as if it happened then. Excuse me, I'm going to have to take a little sip here. So when that happened, he realized, oh my goodness, I thought I was done with that. Not done. So he knew that he had some forgiveness work to do. And so then what came up after that, which I know comes up in my experience, is after he'd done his healing work and forgiveness work with her, the bigger piece of work was to forgive himself, I was sharing this, you know, when I was sharing about that, I was led to call him. So I called him and we had this beautiful talk, very deep talk. And he said, you know, I've never really given a talk on forgiveness. And I said, I haven't either. And Shannon and I have talked about that. And she's asked me why not. And I said, because I don't have anything to say, which you might find kind of weird thinking I don't have something to say. Most people, when they think of Deborah, that's not the first thing that comes to her head. She's not going to have anything to say. Even when I don't think I'm going to have something to say, I do. But forgiveness, I've never given a talk on it because I didn't think I had anything to say. And he laughed and he said, oh my goodness, I feel the same thing. And then he laughed and he said, I feel a talk on forgiveness coming through. I said, I bet you do. I want to hear that talk. I want to hear that talk. So maybe a book I have given more than any other book is this book called Love is Letting Go of Fear. Its simplicity is its profoundness. Jerry Champolsky, that I mentioned later, took the principles in the Course in Miracles and he put them into this sweet book with lots of pictures. I like books that have pictures. So he has some suggested themes to live by. And they just have to do with, it's hard to do this with just two hands. Okay. Themes to live by. It could be helpful to keep the following underlying themes in mind. Peace of mind is our single goal. Forgiveness is our single function and the way to achieve our goal of peace. 3. Through forgiveness, we can learn not to judge others and to see everyone, including ourselves, as guiltless. We can let go of the fear when we stop judging and stop projecting the past into the future and live only in the here and now. We can learn to accept direction from our inner intuitive voice, which is our guide to knowing. After our inner voice gives us direction, it will also provide the means for accomplishing whatever is necessary. So I think that that really kind of speaks to this conversation that I'm having with you, right? About the power of forgiveness, the power of forgiveness. So last week, I was having a couple of very heated conversations, very heated. The thing that was in common in both of them was I was the only person in both conversations. I was doing my part, I was doing their part, and I would go from one to the other, and then every so often I would go, stop! And I'd stop for 2 minutes, and then there I was again, obsessing about, you know, who had irritated me and this circumstance, and I was judging, and oh, not a happy place. But I was going back and forth. There's a great line. I think it may originally have come from A Course in Miracles. Do I want to be right or happy? I wanted to be right. And I was willing to attack others in my thoughts. I was even willing to change my story so I could continually be right. Was not a peaceful place. It was not a peaceful place. So on Thanksgiving Day, I was getting ready to go out for I call them trail trots with my JB. And before I went, I was thinking about, I didn't want to have a repeat experience of Wednesday's trail trot. Because on Wednesday's trail trot, the whole time I was obsessing. Whole time. There was beauty everywhere around me and I didn't see it. Every so often I would say, look at the beauty. I'd look at the beauty. And then before I knew where I was, back to my obsessive thinking. And so I said to myself, you are not going to do that again. You are not going to do that again. And then I thought about the acronym HOME, Healing Opportunities Manifest Everywhere. And as I was driving to the trail, I was pretty close to begging God, please let me have a healing opportunity on this trail. I need some help. Please, I need some help. I want a healing opportunity here. So I got on the trail with my JB and I was just a couple of minutes into it and spontaneously this just happened. All of a sudden, I was saying, I forgive myself. 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 I did that for an hour. We were gone on our trail trot for an hour and there was never a break in it. I was saying it gently out loud. Luckily, I didn't go by anybody on the trail, you know, but it was spontaneous. I forgive myself. So then I was running back up to my car and I was stretching and the I forgive myself stopped. So I got in my car and I was driving home and all of a sudden it was, you are forgiven. You are forgiven. You are forgiven. It was like, wow. And so I did that on the way home, which was about 10 minutes. And then when I got out of my car, it was real clear that process was finished. I'm not saying forgiveness is finished. But that round of forgiveness, it was real clear that round was finished. And I have to tell you, I got out of my car feeling light and feeling freer. And I was not obsessing. Oh, I forgot to tell you my one funny thought on the way there. My favorite chapter in all of Ernest Holmes' books is in Living the Science of Mind. And it's a chapter called The Peace That Is Within You. And my favorite line in that chapter, which I told myself when I was driving there, I thought I knew it. Oh, this is it. The peace that healed the lunatic of his obsessive thinking. I think I forgot to mention that I was saying to myself when I was driving there, because it brought a little humor, was when he said, the peace that healed the lunatic of his obsessive thinking. Anybody ever felt like a lunatic when you're stuck in your obsessive thinking? I love that. The peace that healed the lunatic of his obsessive thinking. And that was what happened. That was what happened. I got out of my car and I was no longer obsessing. And it was a beautiful thing. That was a beautiful thing. I have another. Where's that reading? So it became real clear to me, as I was contemplating what happened, that I was starting to have an inkling about not just what forgiveness might be, but how to achieve it, because that had worked. And so I'd like to read you Jerry Champolsky. He has, what does he call them? He calls them lessons for personal transformation. And one of them is called Forgiveness is the Key to Happiness. So check this out, because this is exactly what happened to me that day. Inner peace can be reached only when we practice forgiveness. Forgiveness is the vehicle for changing our perceptions and letting go of our fears, condemning judgments, and grievances. Forgiveness then becomes a process of letting go and overlooking whatever we thought other people may have done to us, or whatever we may think we have done to them. When we see our only function as forgiveness and are willing to practice it consistently by directing our minds to be forgiven, we find ourselves released and set free. And that was how I felt, released and set free. Forgiveness corrects the misperception that we are separate from each other, and it allows us to experience a sense of unity and at one-ment with each other. And so when I was reading that, it was like, oh my goodness, that's exactly what had just happened. And I really resonated with it. But it was also interesting to be reminded of the power of righteousness. The power of righteousness. When I was lamenting over the fact that I didn't have a talk title, I kind of was trying to make one about gratitude. But truthfully, if you were here last week or if you watched it online, my friend Don the Buddhist did a beautiful job about talking about the grateful heart. And I know Peggy has it out online. And It was a very beautiful talk. And when I talked last time, I mentioned that I felt like there were many things that take us away from home, that place that knows peace. And I talked about the three C's: complain, criticize, and compare. I talked about them as three ways that I think can take us away from our spiritual home. And the antidote to all of those, I think we can think of as gratitude, And I also think it's always struck me as a little strange. In England, we don't have Thanksgiving, but it's always struck me as a little strange that we kind of have this one day where gone out again. We have this one day where we're having some technical issues. Okay, is that better? Yeah. Yeah. So I think that, you know, what if we practice gratitude every day? And I do have to say that I have huge gratitude in my heart that I'm starting to have a little bit of understanding about how to forgive. And that maybe it's not this big thing. Maybe it is as simple as I forgive myself and doing it over and over, and then I am forgiven. And I think it wasn't an accident that I spent an hour doing I forgive myself and about 6 or 7 minutes saying I am forgiven. Because the truth is, God has always forgiven us. God has always forgiven us. So then there was another one of these lessons for personal transformation that kind of went along with this conversation that I'm having with you. Today, I will judge nothing that occurs. How about that? Today, I will judge nothing that occurs. Have you ever given yourself the opportunity of going through just one day concentrating on totally accepting everyone and making no judgments? No, I haven't done that. I don't know about you. I'm going to say it again. Maybe there's somebody here who has done that, but I haven't. Have you ever given yourself the opportunity of going through just one day concentrating on totally accepting everyone and making no judgments? Most of us manifest a condition which could be called tunnel vision. We do not see people as a whole. We see just a fragment of a person, and our mind often interprets what we see as a fault. However, this is the good news. All that is really necessary is our willingness to begin practicing being non-judgmental without expecting instant perfection. The relinquishing of old habits that we do not want comes with repeated and sustained practice. To experience unconditional love, we must get rid of the evaluator part of ourselves. In place of the evaluator, we need to hear our strong inner voice saying to ourselves and others, I totally love and accept you as you are. I totally love and accept you as you are. Well, I was really good with this until that last line. I totally love and accept you as you are. Because I could think at least a handful of people that I had no interest in accepting and loving them exactly who they are. Not happening. Just not happening. And then I realized that the whole thing didn't work for me. I totally love and accept you as who I am. When I was thinking about the people that I had been obsessing about, and it's been really interesting this week since I've started this, how many people from my past are coming into my consciousness. I'm thinking about guys I dated 20 years ago that I haven't thought about in forever. So it's been interesting. All these people that just keep coming into my consciousness. And I realized I can't do that. I can't say with integrity, I totally love and accept you as you are, because I don't. But what I realized I could say was, I bless you and I release you. I could do that. I bless you and I release you. And so for the last few days, every time somebody comes up and I start to go into the, you know, judgment or blame or circumstances that I feel are contributing to whatever difficulties I may feel I have in life, I've stopped myself and I can do, I bless you and I release you. I bless you and I release you. It's been super cool. And I do it until I don't need to do it anymore. So what I've been learning this week, going back to the answers are always in the back. The answers are always in the back. The answers are always there behind whatever attacking thoughts, judgment, unforgiveness, suffering, whatever it is that's going on in my head. The answers are always, always at the back of all of that. Always. Because that place that we call home is not capable of leaving us. It can't leave us. It's not possible. We can leave it, but it cannot leave us. It cannot leave us. And so I'm pretty excited that I think that maybe for me, this talk has been like forgiveness 101. And as I start to really kind of think about it more and see what percolates and see what answers are in the back about forgiveness for me, hopefully I will have some more things to share about it. But this simple process I did, yesterday morning, I woke up at about 5 and I wasn't even awake hardly before my mind was saying, I forgive myself, I forgive myself, I forgive myself. It just keeps starting by itself. It's been really quite fascinating. It's been really fascinating. So the blurb for this week, the affirmation was there is no place like home. And then I meant to read this at the beginning, but it doesn't matter. The blurb for this week is the keys to the home of our dreams are in our heart and mind. We unlock the possibility and joy of being at home wherever we go. So that's what we've been thinking about today. Forgiveness as the key to being in that home. And in light of the answers always being at the back, when we can think about, well, okay, how am I going to do that? You know, I'm going to give us another literal. The answers are in the back page. I'm really into these back pages, I tell you. So this is the back page of Love is Letting Go of Fear. Literally, the answers are always in the back, the epilogue. Let us consistently choose the single goal of peace rather than multiple goals that lead to conflict. Let us continue to practice forgiveness and to see each other and ourselves as blameless. Let us look lovingly upon the present, for it holds only knowledge that is forever true. Let us continue to be involved in a process of personal transformation in which we are only concerned about giving and not getting. Let us recognize that we are united as one self and illuminate the world with the light of love that shines through us. Let us awaken to the knowledge that the essence of our being is love, and as such, we are the light of the world. So here's to, both literally and metaphorically, that the answers are always in the back. And so it is. So when we have our offertory, it's the moment where we can just check within ourselves and just feel grateful for all the myriad of ways that spirit blesses our life. From the moment we wake up with our beautiful sunrises to the moment we go to bed and our gorgeous sunsets. Knowing that every day is a day to say thank you, God. Master Eckhart, the brilliant mystic, said if we were only to have one prayer, let it be thank you. Thank you, God. So this is our opportunity to give of our treasures as we say thank you, God. We have an exciting event coming up. On December 11th, our friends at the Everyday Center for Spiritual Living are going to be joining us. So we are going to have a service together. And then afterwards, we're going to have some social time. I invite you to bring some finger foods, nothing that requires a fork or a knife. And we'll have some socializing with our friends at Everyday Center for Spiritual Living. So please put that on your calendar. We are very excited that they want to come join with us and celebrate with us December 11th. So please plan to be here. Who's speaking that day? I think it would be me.
What a wonderful talk. And I thought about what I would like to perform another song. And I feel like this goes really beautifully with what Deborah just spoke about. When I lived in Nashville, I was friends with a lady whose spiritual path was called Ekankar. And one of the things that they say is Baraka Bashad. And that means may the blessings be. So she came to me at one point and said, I'd like to write a song. Can you help me out? And so this is a sing-along, and it's called Baraka Bashad. And the chorus, Baraka, Baraka, Baraka Bashad, Baraka, Baraka Bashad. So you'll get the idea. And if you get a chance, sing along.
Grace of God, praise the Rabbi Shah.